Ready, Theo?
This is my friend's dog, Theo.
Theo, look at me.
He's so cute.
And this is Thomas Hymus, a computer scientist with excellent fashion sense. Thomas is going to turn this photo of Theo into DNA.
So once this is done processing, we'll have a vial. Inside that vial will be the dog photos.
There will be dog photos in the vial, yes.
It all has to do with this chart. The amount of data we create is growing exponentially, and storing it is becoming unsustainable. So governments and companies are looking for alternative solutions, investing millions in some pretty far-out technology, like storing it in vials of DNA. So how on earth can this replace this? Let's talk about our data problem for a second. Data storage is becoming smaller, cheaper, and more efficient each year. But our appetite for data is growing fast. Next year, we're expected to hit 175 zettabytes of data being stored on this planet. That's the equivalent of 43 trillion feature films. Most of it lives in places like this, which use up huge amounts of electricity and water, and in general are just pretty bad for the environment.
We have to continue finding better ways of storing data. There's just no question.
The most popular way to store data is on disk and tape. Yes, that tape, sort of. Disk is quick access and powerful, but it runs hot and it needs to be cooled and replaced every 3 to 5 years. Tape is slower access, but it's much cheaper and easier to store. It can last for up to 10 years or longer, so it's mostly used for archival storage. But both take up a lot of space. This is where DNA comes into the picture.
DNA data storage, it's very old and very new. DNA is built to store data, right? It stores the information needed to make human beings from a single cell into tens of trillions of cells that make up our body.
The main selling point of DNA is its density.
Think about flash storage, those USB keys, right? So the actual chip inside, we're actually reaching the limits of how dense we can store the data there. And that's one of the densest things you can buy today. You know, 100,000 times, a million times denser than that, that's what DNA would be.
It also has the potential to last a lot longer than disk or tape storage.
As long as the DNA is cold and dry, you can reliably store data for hundreds, even thousands of years, without even necessarily using electricity.
This means DNA should reduce carbon emissions compared with traditional storage. This rough estimate from Microsoft's own research says in the best case scenario, DNA beats disk and tape storage in carbon emissions, energy use, and water consumption. The problem is, this is all still very theoretical. The technology hasn't yet been able to put more than a few gigabytes into DNA. And that estimate from Microsoft, that's their best case scenario. In the worst case scenario, DNA storage can actually be worse for the environment than tape storage. We'll get into that a bit later. Still, the tech giant thinks it's worth a bet, and they are partnering with Washington University and scientists like Louis Cézé on research.
The industry is very interested, and we're convinced that this works.
Other major investors include the US government and the DNA Data Storage Alliance, made up of bioscience, data storage, and big tech companies. So, how close to reality are we? Let's go back to Thomas Hymus. His lab has spent 3 years working on an end-to-end DNA storage prototype at the Imperial College in London with funding from the EU. This is the first time they've worked on a digital image.
He's very introspective dog.
He's thinking, isn't he? Yeah.
There are three parts to converting data to DNA and back again. Writing, synthesizing, and reading. All digital data, like this photo of Theo, is stored in bits, combinations of the numbers 1 and 0. The writing phase essentially converts these ones and zeros into a script for DNA, which looks like this. When you look at the steps on the ladder of this double helix structure, they're made up of four bases: A, T, C, G.
map a 00 to an A, a 01 to a T, a 10 to a C, and a 11 to a G, right?
The next step is synthesis, and it's where the limitations of DNA data storage start to appear. Close it. Heiner says this DNA synthesis machine would take weeks or months to process my photo, which means we need to send it to another lab which has industrial-sized equipment.
I think it's going to be considerably quicker, a couple of minutes or 20 minutes, half an hour to write a couple of megabytes or something like that.
DNA synthesis is also an extremely costly process right now. The DNA Data Storage Alliance estimates each gigabyte of data in DNA would cost $1,300 to synthesize right now. But the price is dropping year by year.
Our main competitor for DNA storage today is tape. So we need to be as fast in writing, roughly as fast in reading, and also pretty much on the same level of costs, if not lower. We're nowhere near.
There's also the environmental problem. The main way to synthesize DNA right now is using chemicals, some of which are made with propane.
So the technology at the moment we're using is rather harmful or involves a lot of toxic reagents. So there's already new technology out there, enzymatic synthesis, that will change that. It's just a little bit immature at the moment.
Good boy, come here. All of these reasons, chemicals, cost, time, means it's probably going to be some years before I can put more of my photos of Theo into DNA.
I think we're a couple of years off still. It's probably 5-10 years.
My guess that we're going to measure that in close to decades than we are 2 years.
Absolutely.
So what happens to this table here?
When it's fully realized, even advocates say DNA will likely be limited to archival storage for vast amounts of files that companies and governments would like to keep for as long as and as cheaply as possible, similar to the role tape storage plays right now.
Will be, you know, data centers today have a bunch of disks or a bunch of tapes, and then maybe DNA data storage for long-term archival, right? Consumers will probably not get in touch with technology directly, at least initially.
Hi, Thomas.
Hello.
Good to see you again.
So this is the DNA here, right? And yeah, you can see the little droplets there.
Right, so the same photo, just in different forms right now. This one's in bytes,
looks a bit nicer on the right, yes. Yeah,
okay, so I'm going to start the reading process now.
You see these little strings there, or these little lines? This is basically, each one of them is a molecule, and each molecule stores about 10 pixels or something in that order, and it kind of reconstructs slowly.
Yeah.
I mean, so far I'm happy with this, but towards the end it's getting mostly nervous.
It took about a month and cost £800. But the lab did turn Theo into DNA.
That looks like it's kind of done.
It's pretty much done, yeah. The image is pretty much reconstructed. The worry was that we might have a couple of pixels missing and so on. But it worked very well, so I'm super happy about that.
Thanks for watching. This video is part of our series called Hard Copy, looking at the physical footprint that data leaves on our planet. Subscribe for more.